Okay, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's time to start the I²CNER seminar. My name is Xavier Sauvage. I'd like to introduce, it's a great pleasure to introduce Dr. Xavier Sauvage from the University of Iowa. I'd like to introduce a little bit my backgrounds. He is the research scientist in CNRS, Physics Institute, Section 5. Probably you're familiar with the French system, then you know the system, but the time's a limit, so I just skip to the next background. He graduated 1996, a student of the Ecole Normale Supérieure de Fashion in France. I'm not sure whether this is a correct pronunciation or not, but this French is very difficult. So. And then he graduated, and he took the Master of Science, so Physics of Material, University of Lugan, and also got the PhD 2001, University of Lugan. And now, well, he spent the Max Planck Institute 2001 to 2002. He had the good activity on the metals and material science. Because of this, he got the awards. 2004 gold medal award from the TMS and the Metallurgical Society of the US, and also APMS and lifter awards in 2010, Federation of European Materials Societies. His special field is introduced today, but he is working on the atom probe tomography. It's a special technique that can resolve the atomic levels and analysis. Also, transmission electron microscopy. We also have the arms. This is CS corrected, very high advanced electron microscopy. So, show us some results today. Metallic materials and the sum of material is processed by the spare parts information that we are involved in. So we start the process up here as Hosh, the same as today.
Thank you, Professor Rovita. Your French pronunciation is just perfect.
Okay, thank you very much.
Before starting, I would like to thank you, all of you, for joining this seminar today, and also to thank Professor Horita for inviting me here, giving me the opportunity to do this lecture today. We have some, I think, an interesting week, and it's really my pleasure to come to Kyushu University. I realize that the title of my talk is a bit long. But here you have most of the keywords, and you see here energy applications. So I will speak a little bit about energy, a little bit about plastic deformation. I don't know how familiar you are with this, but I will make a short introduction to that. Ultra fine grain materials or nanostructure, and for this we need microscope to look at that. So I will also say a few things about the microscopes we are using. And maybe phase transformation, but maybe not so much, because I don't know how familiar you are with all this stuff. So I will try to, I know that you might come from a very different field, so I will try to make it as easy as possible for all of you. Before starting, just a few words about the place I'm coming from. So I'm coming from France, as Professor Rita explained, from the University of Rouen. I'm almost sure that probably none of you already heard about the city before. It's a quite small city. This is not France, only a part of it. I'm sure you know Paris. I'm sure you know London, and you know Brussels. So you see it just in this area, just between England and Paris, not far from the ocean. So we have beautiful ocean landscape. And this is a very old city from the Middle Ages, so it's a beautiful place. And we have a lab of material science there at the university. So here is some figures, so it does change almost all the time, so it's just some approximate numbers. But you see that we have about 50 personnel with a permanent position, and we have quite a lot of engineers and technicians as well, and the number of PhDs, around 40 students who made a PhD in the group. So it's probably much smaller than your institute, but anyway, we try to do our best to solve some material science problem. And all these people are distributed in different teams, so here is a list of the team. I'm not sure it's worth reading all these. Anyway, you see we have people working on magnetic materials, people working on oxidation, on materials for microelectronics, people working on phase transformation modeling. It's more the classical metallurgy, I would say. Here, I have underlined here because this is a team I'm leading in the lab. So we do some work on materials under extreme conditions, and extreme conditions for us, that's irradiation or severe plastic deformation. And all our activities are more or less related to materials for application in the energy. We have also some people involved in mechanics of material. And all these people distributed in all this team, the common point I would say is we use our microscopy facility to solve our material science problem. So most of us are microscopists. And for some historical reasons, I will explain a bit later on. A lot of people in the lab do atom probe tomography. You see that we have three machines for material science and two machines for instrumentation, because we have an instrumentation team, people trying to improve the mass resolution of the instruments, the resolution, and so on. So this is a really big part in the lab. And 4 years ago, we got a new electron microscope, the Japanese one, this one, maybe you heard about it. And now we are doing more and more atom probe combined with TEM. And I will explain you why it would be so important to combine these two techniques. And as you may know, for special preparation, sometimes it's very useful to have fields, so we have two dual beam fields. I'm almost sure, but not sure anyway, I think that most of you are not familiar with atom probe tomography, because I was saying that this technique is not available at Kyushu University, so I decided to put five or six slides, I don't know exactly, about this technique just to tell you the background. This way, when I will show you images after that, you will at least know how it works and how we collected them. So just a few words about atom probe tomography. You see we have different machines, some of them are black, others are white, but anyway, the size of it is like a scanning electron microscope, it's not so much bigger. So it's smaller than a transmission electron microscope. And I like this image, it's a bit old machine, but it's nice because we see everything. One chamber, two chambers, three chambers. So this is the introduction chamber for sample, the storage chamber, analysis chamber. Here we have the detector. Soon you will notice this better because I will explain. And here you see a little box behind it, a femtosecond laser that we use in this machine. And here we have pressure and temperature controllers, and here all the electronics. So why is it so complex? Why do we have all this? That's what I'm going to try to explain now. But before, what can we get with that? This is a typical example of what you could get with an atom probe tomography. You see everything here. You have 3D, and you have a chemical map at the nanometer scale. So it's 3D chemical mapping at the atomic scale. This is what we can get. So here, this is just, sorry, we have to explain, the 3D volume. So we have analyzed little volume of material. This is a copper aluminium nanocomposite. So you see we have very fine scale structure. And here it shows the distribution of copper in blue and the distribution of vanadium. So we have very long and very thin nanofilament of vanadium inside the copper matrix. Now it works. So the physical principle of atom probe is very different if you compare with TEM or X-ray diffraction or SEM, because here we don't have external radiation source. We don't have an electron, we don't have an X-ray, we just have our sample. And the sample is almost everything, that's why it's so important. And the physical principle is electric field evaporation of atoms. If you have a very high electric field, you see it's huge, what you need between 1 and 5 mV per nanometer, then you may evaporate atoms by electric field. And the way we get such a high electric field is, I would say, a very simple way. We put as a sample at the tip like that. You see the scale here that's 200 nanometer. And if you apply high voltage to this tip here, the field you get there is proportional to the voltage over radius ratio. So if you make a simple calculation to get this high field, if you apply a few kilovolt on your sample, you need a radius smaller than 50 nanometer. That's why it is so small. But if you do that, then you have enough field to feed the evaporate. So now this is my T in the schematic representation. We cool it down to reduce atomic vibration, so we work at cryogenic temperature. In front of it, we have a detector, and we are going to evaporate atoms from the surface. This is a very old technique, you see, from 16. So it's more than 50 years old, when invented by Erwin Müller. And by applying this high voltage here, we get the electric field, we evaporate atoms, we collect them from the detector. I will not explain the technology of the detector, but we are able to detect single events, one atom, one ion coming to the detector. And we do time of flight modeling. So when we do atom probe, we do time of flight spectrometry. It's a mass spectrometer. So it is not very complicated. We make the very simple assumption that atoms of the surface, they are ionized and evaporated in the electric field. So they are ions. The energy of these ions is here. And all this energy is converted into kinetic energy. So half times the mass times the square of the speed. So here in this equation, what you want to know is the mass. Then you know which kind of atom it is. The flight length, we know it, is the design of the machine. So if you manage to measure the time of flight, then you know which kind of atom you get on the detector. To measure the time of flight, you need to know when your atom leaves the sample and when it comes to the detector. So when it comes to the detector, it gives us an electric signal, it's quite easy, but when does it leave the sample, this we don't know. So the trick to know when atoms leave the sample, we do not apply a standing voltage, but standing voltage plus pulses. So at the end of the tip, what you get is a pulse of electric field. And on the top of each pulse, the field is higher than the field you need to evaporate. So now we know when atoms are able to leave the sample, only here. And the pulse width is extremely sharp. It's only 1 nanosecond. This way we have very good accuracy on the time of flight. And this is typically what you get when you do atom probe. So it's not three-dimensional atom probe, just mass spectrometry. Here we have analyzed a metallic alloy containing nickel, vanadium, and aluminium. Here is just the number of atoms that we have collected as a function of the mass over charge ratio. Because in this equation, this a priori, you don't know what is the charge of your ion. But anyway, you see that we have enough mass resolution to separate different nickel isotopes. There are 5 nickel isotopes. And then if you want to measure the composition of the material you have analyzed, it's very simple, because here we just count atoms. So there is no more, it's a direct method. So there is no more simple way to do it. What is the magnification? What the size of the volume we can analyze? So I don't have time to go into the details. You will have to trust me a little bit. I could prove this. But it's a projection microscope. So if I have an atom on the surface, it will be projected to the detector following a very, very simple law, very close to a quasi-stereographic projection. So there is a common projection point for all these atoms, and they follow all of them more or less a linear trajectory. So then if you know the distance, if you know the radius, of course the distance is much longer than the radius, we have typically 50 centimeters, then you can calculate the magnitude. You see that it is 1 million. So we have enough magnification here to get atomic resolution. The only thing you know you need, if you know the projection load, is a position sensitive detector. So a detector that is able to measure the time flight, but as well to know the position of your atom. And this is a tricky point. And it took some time for people to be able to do that. The first position sensitive detector was proposed by Alfred Sarrazin from Oxford in 88. And 5 years later, you see, I put this name. Professor Gavet was my PhD supervisor, by the way. So he was the head of the lab. And this way, beginning of the 90s, we were one of the first labs able to make three-dimensional atom probe in the world. And this is why I explained at the beginning, we have 5 atom probes in the lab and still some people doing instrumentation. This is from the history, this long time history of developing position sensitive detectors for high-power tomography. Okay, so this is my sample. I applied pulses, it is very cold. I forgot to mention that, of course, here you don't want molecules, you don't want gas, you want vacuum. So here you have UHV, ultra high vacuum, typically 10 minus 10 or 10 minus 11 millibar. And here I have my position sensitive detector, not exactly where it works, but it works pretty well. And then I evaporate my sample, atomic layer after atomic layer. And here we have evaporated few atomic layers. And you see here the scale, very high magnification, I told you. I have coated only the copper atoms. This is a piece of material analyzed in steel. Steel is mainly iron with a bit of copper. And copper in this kind of steel makes small particles. And here you see copper nanoparticle, few nanometer inside. Of course, I do not show the iron atoms. We collect all of them. But if I show iron atoms, you will not see any more of this. But here it's just 2D. Okay, I evaporate it, collect it onto the detector. But then you can continue. And then it's just like tomography. We stack, it's like more or less stacking images. It's not exactly like this, but almost. And then you can get the 3D reconstruction of your analyzed volume. So we have analyzed all this volume, collected all atoms, and then computed the 3D reconstruction. And now you see your copper particle in 3D. So comparing to the TEM, for example, TEM, you don't have a 3D information. Few key figures, especially about the spatial resolution, what is the resolution of the instrument. So there are some very important parameters like the analysis temperature, the kind of detector you use, and of course the magnification you get is a kind of compromise. But anyway, we are used to speak about two different resolutions due to some physical reasons. There is a depth resolution, and it's typically one atomic plane in crystalline material between 1 and 2 angstrom, because we really evaporate atomic layer after atomic layer. But the natural resolution is not that good. You see about 5 angstrom, I would say. It's because this very simple law I told you about is true, but it's just another kind of assumption. So we have some little deviation to this law. So this is something difficult to avoid, and we have about 5 angstrom. But anyway, we have a resolution better than 1 nanometer. And all I said up to now is not completely the past, but mostly the history. Because in 2005, so it's less than 10 years ago, before that, I should say, some people realized that we could evaporate atoms using a laser, just applying a constant voltage here and applying laser pulses. But before 2005, most of pulsed lasers, you got only nanosecond pulses. And it's quite a high amount of energy that you bring to your sample, and you get heating of the sample. And due to this heating, then you get atomic diffusion and so on. You do not want this. And analysis were not quantitative. And in 2005, some people in my lab tried to use femtosecond lasers, so with very, very short pulses. And this way, they have shown that it is possible to evaporate atoms from your sample using femtolaser second pulses. And why is it so important? Is simply because everything I've said before the laser story is limited to materials with a high electrical conductivity. So basically, the technique was limited only to metals. Now, if you use a laser, you do not send your electric pulse to this tip that is an open line. So you are not going to get attenuation if you use a laser. And thanks to laser atom probe, now the technique has developed to a much larger field in material science. Here I have just selected a few examples. Most of them are in the nanoelectronic area. Here it's a zinc oxide, so we can analyze oxide. Here is some silicon, and here is also some silicon implantation in silicon, for example. So now there is a much larger variety of material that we can analyze than before. Of course, it's still limited to, I would say, massive material. If you have nanoparticles, how can you make a tip in a nanoparticle? It's not possible, so you will have trouble. Okay, as I explained in the beginning of my talk, we are combining transmission electron microscopy and atom tomography. You are probably more familiar with transmission electron microscopy, so I have these three slides, I think, just to refresh your memory if you are not very familiar with this technique. And I will tell only about analytical transmission electron microscopy, so especially scanning transmission electron microscopy, where you have an electron beam, you focus to get a very small probe, and then you scan your sample. And using different detectors, you collect signals to get analysis or to get image information. So typically, when you send your electrons to your sample, you get X-ray emissions. So you can collect this X-ray, and depending on the energy, you can make some chemical map or chemical composition measurement. And we do also some energy loss spectroscopy for electrons losing some energy while crossing the sample. And for imaging, what is very useful and what we like very much is using the high angle annular dark field detector. So this detector is collecting electrons inelastically scattered to high angle. And here, this is a very schematic representation of the scattered amplitude as a function of the atomic number. And heavy atoms, usually with heavy atom, you have more inelastically scattered electrons to high angle. So it gives you a Z contrast, and this is very useful for imaging. So now this is the last slide about microscopy. Just to summarize what you can do using these two techniques and what is the advantage of one comparing to the other one. So that's some data from my colleague on magnesium alloy. So magnesium is very soft. If you put a bit of alloying element, then you could get strong hardening, and this hardening is due to the bright plates that you see here. And this is a high angle annular dark field image. These elements are heavier than the magnesium, so that's why it's bright. And here, with the microscope we have, it's a probe corrected microscope. It means that we correct the spherical aberration of the condenser lens, so we can make a probe as small as one angstrom. So this way, the probe size is smaller than the distance you have typically this material between atoms. So here we scan the material, and you see that you get an image at the atomic scale. You see atomic columns, and here the bright stuff in the middle is like here, but at a higher scale. And if you choose the presence of yttrium, zinc, and sometimes also manganese. And here we have informed crystallography information. Here we have chemical information. So you could say, OK, I have everything with a TEM. No, you don't have everything because you don't have, you have only two dimensions. It's a projection because you go through your sample. That's the first point. And the second point is, if you want to know how much yttrium or zinc you still have here in the matrix, it's impossible. You don't have enough sensitivity. So that's a big advantage of atom probe. You can get a much higher sensitivity for composition measurement. We have a 3D information. So for example, this nanoparticle here, if you look at it, it could have any shape in the third dimension with atom probe you see. And we have access to local concentration and gradients if you want to know the composition gradient across the interface. For plates with TEM, okay, you can manage, but if it's a sphere, you will never get it, or it will be very hard. With atom probe, it's much easier. Okay, I'm back now to the original title of my presentation. It was more kind of introduction about the experimental techniques we used. As I say, I will. The title and by energy applications, but I will start by the motivation of our work. So probably you understood from the beginning of this talk, I do some work on metals, so more the metallurgy stuff. And if you think about different alloys available for our everyday life and that we absolutely need for aircraft, cars, or trains, aluminium is a very interesting guy because it is light, especially important for aircraft, and it could be strong. And of course, if you manage to develop stronger aluminum alloys, keeping the low weight, then you could you have a big demand for lighter frames in the automotive industry just to save some energy. So that's the main motivation. But it's not only for the automotive industry. It's also because aluminum, okay, is light. It could be strong, but also it could be a good electricity conductor. And it's also much cheaper than copper. You know that we why do you use copper as electrical conductor? In every car, you have 7 kilograms of copper just for the wire. So that's an additional weight. So there is also a big demand to try to develop high strength, good conductivity, and low weight cables made of aluminum. So here's that some example to show that it's not a new idea. But of course, the idea is to make them always stronger and stronger. Here it's a map. It's taken from this website. Here it shows the electrical resistivity as a function of the strengths. And it's maybe a bit complicated to read, but anyway, this area here is where you can play with conventional aluminum alloys. And here is a copper. So you see copper has a lower resistivity, that's good. And could have quite high strengths. I'm not sure that we can go up to this point with copper, but anyway. And aluminum could compete quite well with copper in this area. And here's another way to show different things. Here is the strength, and here is the conductivity. The main difference is here it was resistivity, and now it's reversed. And also, now I have linear scales to make things a bit easier. Here is pure aluminum. Pure aluminum is extremely soft. We don't want it. You see the yield stress is absolutely low. If you alloy, then typically you increase the yield stress, but you decrease the conductivity. And the best we can do so far with classical alloys is somewhere here. And what we would like to do is to jump there. So how can we do that? I don't know how familiar you are with metallurgy, but if you want to increase the strength of alloys, there are two possibilities. The first one is to play with the chemistry. So this is a metallurgical route, you play with metallurgy. So you're going to alloy your aluminum. And by alloying, you could get solid solution, it makes strengthening. Or you could get precipitates. Precipitates is small particles. And I underline this one because solid solutions, you don't want it if you want electrical applications because it's very bad, it decreases strongly the conductivity. So we are going to play only with precipitates today. So here is a typical example of what you could do. If you take aluminum, you put a bit of copper, you see the scale here, we make plate-shaped nanoscale precipitates. Here is an HAATF image, so that contrast. Here is a plate with lots of copper inside. In the aluminum matrix. And this makes your material stronger because the plasticity in this kind of metal is controlled by dislocation motions. Dislocations are defects, and dislocations can hardly propagate if you have so much obstacles in the material. So this is the first possibility. Then if you want to make your material stronger, there is another way to go. This is what I call the structural route. So you change the structure by what is called by mechanical engineering strain hardening. You do deformation, you increase the dislocation density, it will make your material harder. Or you make small grains, and this is absolutely not new. Since I think the 50s, some people realize that making grains smaller make your material harder. Because grain boundaries are also obstacles for the dislocations. And this is a typical hole and patch loop from these two guys who have proposed this loop, and you see that the strength is inversely proportional to the square root of the grain size. This is the grain size here. And I have underlined this because what we want to do now is to combine small precipitates and small grains. And we want to combine them in an optimal way to get strong alloys with good conductivity and also low weight. But now if you want to make small grains, you have troubles. How can we make small grains? In a typical aluminum alloy, the grain size is between, let's say, 30 and 100 micrometer. And we want them 1 or 2 orders of magnitude smaller. How can we do that? So you have two ways to make small grains in metallic alloy. You have the bottom-up approach. You start from nanoparticles, you put them together, you sinter, and then you have your material. Or the top-down approach, and using severe plastic deformation is one example of it, and that's what I'm going to tell you now. Sintering of nanoparticles could be very promising. The problem you have is, with this kind of process, usually you get some porosities or some defects, especially food density is very difficult to rich, and also if you have contamination of your powders with oxide, it's difficult to get rid of it. So a top-down approach is much more providing. So what is severe plastic deformation process? I'm sure you know the word deformation, you know the word plastic, and you know the word severe. So it's just that we do large level of deformation. We deform the material to a very large level of deformation. And there are different ways to do that. There are people with lots of imagination, and Professor Omita is one of the leaders in the field. For example, some people have invented this crazy process where you have here a die. This is a hole in the die. This is a shape. And I'm going to press a little sample through. And when the sample comes here, it has to go out this way. And to go out this way, there is only one way to do that. You need a strong shear in this plane, very strong shear. And then once it's out, if you want to play again, you can play again. You can put it again here. And again and again and again and again. So you can deform more and more and more and more. And if you do that, this is here aluminum alloy, because I'm talking about aluminum. And you see that after doing that, this is here some transmission from records will be invaded. This black stuff here is a grain, another grain, another grain. We get grains with a size that is 1 micron, or it could be even less. So we have reduced the grain size. I have no time to explain the physical mechanisms leading to this kind of dynamic crystallization, but at the end, we get small grains this way. Another process, and most of the work I'm going to show after was done with this process, is called the high pressure torsion. Your material is like a little coin. You press it between two angles, high pressure, and then you just apply some torsion, so you deform by torsion. And then there is no limitation in the deformation you can do. The reason why we need high pressure is to get friction to do that, and also to limit to avoid cracking in yourself. If you don't have high pressure, you cannot deform so much, you need high pressure. And anyway, you see that at the end here is some copper, another example. Here this is a scale. The grain size in this copper alloy one, I think it was pure copper, is much below 1 micron. And this gives some very, very strong increase of the strength of the material because now we have very small grains. So now if I go back to our initial problem, we want to make UAG is ultra-fine grain plus precipitate. I want two things. So we have two possibilities to do that. The first route is to say, okay, first I make my small precipitates, and then I will make my small grains. But if you do that, you will have some problems, because if you have small precipitates, I explained your material is harder to deform. That's the first problem. The second problem is, due to the deformation, you may destroy your precipitates, or even sometimes dissolve them, because if you shear them in several pieces, then they just simply disappear. So you say, no problem, I go the other way around. First, I will make my first small grains, and second, I will make my small precipitates. And here, that's a part of the topic today. You will see that we have some problems sometimes called grain rules for crystallization and heterogeneous precipitations. So, I don't know how much time I still have. Okay, in the next 20 minutes, I will try to finish in 20 minutes. I will try to show you the approach we have. So we work on fundamental on model systems to understand the fundamental mechanisms. So I will show you a few images of aluminium zinc and aluminium copper alloys to explain the problem we have. And also we have some more application-oriented research, and the last example will be on aluminium magnesium silicon alloy, so it's an alloy designed for electric applications. So I don't know how familiar you are with metallurgy and phase diagram. Here is a phase diagram, aluminum, zinc. So here it's aluminum, here it's zinc, and here is temperature. High temperature, it's liquid, low temperature, it's solid, and depending on the temperature, you could have a mixture of aluminum and zinc or phase separation. So just at low temperature, aluminum and zinc. So if you have high temperature, for example at 400 degrees C, you can dissolve 30% of zinc in aluminum. But then if you cool down, you will make aluminum and zinc. That's the way we make our small particles usually. So here what we've done, we've took this alloy at high temperature, where zinc is in solid solution. And then we quench, meaning that we cool down very quickly, down to room temperature, the atomic mobility is near zero, so we freeze the solid solution. And then we deform by the high pressure torsion process I explained before. And when we've done that, we were extremely surprised to see that during the deformation, we get a phase separation. Zinc goes out of the aluminum and we get what we call precipitation. So we get formation of precipitation during the deformation, which was not desired. So here, sorry, that's 10 images, bright field and dark field. Here you have a Z contrast. Everything is bright, it's zinc. So that's some zinc particle. Okay, some of them are very big, some of them are smaller. Here you see the grain boundaries. So I have small grains, at least to manage to do that, small grains. But we have this big particle that we didn't want. So this is one of the first things that happened during the deformation. And looking closer at the microstructure, so here it's a closer look, here it's a big particle at a trigger junction. Here you have a grain boundary. And you see along the grain boundary, it looks bright on the HAATF image. See Z contrast. And if you make a line profile here across the boundary, you see that it's really thin, 1 or 2 nanometers thick. And, well, of course, the idea was it's probably due to zinc at the grain boundary. So here it's another image on the grain boundary. We're showing a very thin layer and enriching zinc. This is EDS map. It was a bit difficult to get some accurate data here. But anyway, if you make a profile across, here you see that the grain boundary is enriched in zinc. So there is something happening during the deformation to this atoms. It's not only deformation of my FCC structure, it's also atoms are playing a strange game here and going to this defect that is a grain boundary. And this is very important if you want to control the grain refinement mechanism, considering our original goal. This is a starting material. I have a supersaturated solid solution. And for some reason I don't know yet, I have my zinc going to the grain boundary. And then because I have lots of zinc there, I have some nucleation of the zinc particles. But, it doesn't tell us how zinc atoms leave this area and go to the boundary. So to try to understand this, we have investigated another alloy. It's aluminum magnesium. Here is a small part of the phase diagram. It's basically the same at high temperature. If you quench, you have also a solid solution. We did high pressure torsion. You see that the grains here are really small now. We have 100 nanometer, much smaller. This is a conventional TEM image. So here you have only diffraction contrast. Now if you go to the stem, you can get Z contrast. And here, forget the right for the moment, just focus on the left. Here you see on the Z contrast image, also magnesium and aluminum are very close in atomic number. We manage to get contrast and all these dark areas here, they are magnesium rich and they are formed during the deformation. Here on the right it's the same kind of image but collected with smaller collection angle. So here we have a kind of mixture between Z contrast and diffraction. But this way you can see the grain boundary and the small grains that we managed to do. And the most surprising thing, we saw this and said, okay, when you look at the phase diagram and you see, we have precipitation, this is aluminum 3 magnesium 2 precipitates. But we did diffraction, the TEM, you can do diffraction, and it was impossible to detect this phase. So then, the only thing you should do is to go to the atom probe and to try to get accurate composition measurements of this magnesium rich stone. That's what we've done. Here is a small image of a volume analyzed by atom probe. Here it's a scandium particle because in this alloy we have also some scandium making particles. Anyway, just focus on the red is magnesium. And you see that magnesium is not homogeneously distributed. This is due to the deformation. We change the distribution of this element. It's probably a grain boundary. Anyway, here, this is original data, sorry. Blue dots, that's the aluminum. Red dots, the magnesium. And from this, we can make a 2D chemical map. Okay? And here, here is a color scale. Purple is 20% magnesium, red is almost zero. And you see that the composition of this magnesium-rich area is, let's say, about 15, average 15 atomic mass, much lower than what we need for the particle, the intermetallic particles I talked about before. So it's not precipitation, it's something different. And then we try to understand how these hadrons move to form this magnesium-rich dome. And from this we move to the classical diffusion theory, and we try to estimate the diffusion coefficient from our experiment. And if we compare with the diffusion coefficient of magnesium in aluminum, you see that if we do deformation at 100 degrees C, we are quite satisfied, but for the room temperature experiment, we have much more diffusivity that we should have. So we try to understand this. Some people pretend that you could get heating during the deformation. Also, some work done in Kyushu University has shown that there is not a significant heating during deformation. Even if it's heating a little bit, then I will shift from zero temperatures here to there. There is still several orders of magnitude, four orders of magnitude between the diffusion coefficient you should have and the one we observe. So then the only possibility is to consider that during the deformation, there is a large amount of point defects that are created, more or less like during irradiation. And it has been shown by several authors that the vacancy concentration could be very high during the deformation. And I don't know if you are familiar about the diffusion in metallic materials, but especially in their systems, we have substitutional atoms, and the diffusion is controlled by the motion of the vacancy. So if I change the vacancy concentration, then my diffusion coefficient is affected by this extra vacancy, and now you see that it changes a lot the diffusion coefficient. So only by understanding all this, we can now take all this phenomena into account to design our materials to try to get small grains and precipitates. And now, just to finish this presentation, just some last example with some properties, because that's also important, so not only on the fundamental aspects. That's an aluminum, magnesium, silicon. Well, I used to put just a bit of magnesium and silicon to get a small particle size of about to get high strengths. We do the same technique. We managed to get small grains. You see the scale? Okay, we are very happy about that. But, of course, it was almost no surprise because we've seen it for the other elements before when we did atom probe tomography just after the processing when we had the small grains. You see here this very elongated area containing lots of zinc. Here is the same volume, but unfortunately on the screen here we have only 2D, so we have to show different view. And you see that's a kind of grain boundary segregation. So there is redistribution of the solute element, and this is absolutely not desired, because all the silicon and magnesium going to the grain boundary, it will give you less magnesium and silicon to form the nanoparticles. So we don't want that. And the other problem we have with this kind of system is, after making the small grains, now we try to make the precipitates. So for this, we heat up a little bit. You see at 130 degrees C during 2 days, low temperature to get some atomic mobility to make small precipitates. That's the bright line you see there, or the green stuff you see here in this EDS map. So we have precipitation. We are very happy, but we are very unhappy because also we've got grain growth. You see the grain size here now is pretty big. And the reason why you get grain growth is because the system wants to minimize its energy, and any defect is bad. So if you get bigger grains, you will have less grain boundaries. So if we look at the properties, then after so here is the hardness, and here is the conductivity. Right after processing, we have very small grains, very high hardness. And now, if I age, if I do aging, you see that the hardness is decreasing due to the grain growth. But the good point is that the conductivity is increasing because my elements, magnesium and silicon, may precipitate. Now I have a pure aluminum matrix with a good conductivity. So anyway, the conclusion of this is that it doesn't work because I wanted small grains and my grains now are big. So how can we do that? What we try to do is to say, okay, we deform at room temperature because it's very convenient. You do it in the lab, no need to do anything, you just but it's possible to heat up your device and to do deformation at a higher temperature. And that's what we've done. So you have green, pink, and blue. That's different temperature. It's 130, 100 degrees room temperature. And you see that if you deform at higher temperature, the hardness is a bit lower. Here is the number of turns we've done by high pressure torsion, and here is the hardness. Anyway, you see that if you deform at higher temperature, you get lower hardness. But the conductivity is better. Here is 130. We have a much better conductivity. This line here is our reference. The reference is the same material but with a classical tool. So we have stronger material with the same conductivity. Not so bad. And the reason why it's not so bad, if we look at the microstructure now, we see that we have small grains, okay, about 200 nanometer in size. And during the deformation, we got precipitation. You see the black dot here, that's a conventional TM image, but if I do analytical measurement, you see that I have my small precipitate here. So what we have here is not a rule number one, explained at the beginning, precipitate and then small grain, not rule number two, where I told you we can make small grains and precipitates. We've done everything at the same time. So it's good, everything at the same time. We've got the small grains and the precipitates. And not enough time to explain you all the details. You could say, well, it's very nice. We have disc-shaped precipitate. It looks like coils, so it's very small. What for applications? So we have other processes, more continuous, making able to make wires. And with these processes, applying similar treatment of deformation and annealing conditions, this is where we managed to go. So this is the initial map, the strength, the conductivity. That's the conventional aluminum wires obtained with this material. And with our process and treatment, we managed to go to this part. So at some point it's good because we have higher strength, higher conductivity. But it's not good enough because you see that the initial target was clear. So we still have some room for some more research and some more improvement. And this is one of the reasons of my visit here, because we have similar projects with Professor Rita, especially how we can control all this process of precipitation and keeping the small grains. I have no conclusion of this talk, but I have some acknowledgement. Most of the work I've shown was done in collaboration with some Russian partners, because in my lab we have microscopes, but we don't have deformation facilities. I would like also to thank again Professor Rita for welcoming me here, and for the nice discussion we had this week, and the opportunity to give this talk today. And all these people here, my students and people from my lab who helped in this work. And thank you for your attention.